Well, as far as I'm concerned, the important thing about 5 is that it's not 3, 4 or 6. And 3, 4 or 6 are each numbers that have really special properties in relation to tiling the plane, so creating repeating patterns of tiles. So I brought some props, and here are squares. These are the sort of squares that we all put on our walls, and the pattern is very simple, and anyone can carry on putting down square tiles, and the pattern repeats itself on and on and on. You don't need instructions because you know how it continues. Now, suppose you wanted something a bit more exotic than that. Let's say you wanted triangle tiles. Say your tiles were triangles like that. Well, you could put the next one upside down and the third one back the same way, and then you can continue, and then you can put the next row in, and you can continue this for as long as you want. So that would carry on for as long as you want, using the same rule again and again and again, just so you know how to put down the tiles, one up, one down. So that's going to be the three. So these are tiles with three sides, three corners. Our original squares had four sides, four corners. But maybe you want something more exotic still, and you want to use hexagonal tiles. So I can use this pattern again, I'll just draw over it. So there was a hexagon. Can you see this red? And I could have another hexagon that would come in. And that one, and my third hexagon, and so. And I can continue to put hexagons down as well. This is what the bees know. And all the bees have to know is where to put the next little cell of their honeycomb. So here's the question. Can we use five-sided? So the answer is no, we can't. Five sides, equal angles. So I might put the next one down here. And now you begin to see your problem, because the bit I'd have to fill in round here is a bigger angle than my pentagon has at its angle. I'd get something like that, and there'd be this little bit of extra space. Now you see, it didn't happen with the hexagons, because the hexagons had just that little bit extra angle, and so they filled in these gaps. So here you won't have another, and you'll get another gap. Triangles, three-sided figures, squares, four-sided figures, and hexagons, six-sided figures, are all good for tiling your wall. But five pentagons is no good. Six is the last one you can do. As soon as you start getting even bigger figures again, there are many sides, then the angles become too shallow, so that the next one would only have a little bit. If I put in another polygon out here to match that one there, I'd end up with only a little slither, and I'd never get something in there. So you can't do seven-sided figures, eight-sided, nine-sided, whatever. The realization there was a problem with pentagons goes back a very, very long way. Kepler knew that there were problems, and no doubt the ancient Greeks did as well. The ancient Greeks had a lot of these interesting tiling patterns. Kepler made a real concerted effort to get interesting patterns using as small a number of different shapes as possible. And he had something that was pretty nice. It contained a lot of structure, but it wasn't as good as what Roger Penrose managed to come up with in the 1970s, which was a tiling using these plus three other shapes appropriate for filling in these gaps, and rules to tell you when to put down a pentagon and when to put in a filling in shape. And he was able to come up with a pattern that went on forever. It had a curious property that it never repeated itself. It kept on changing a little bit as you go along. What Penrose had is he had a systematic way of filling in the gaps and coming up with a pattern where the local configurations of all the tiles kept on appearing again and again, just in a different order. So there was constant slight changes, but the local patches all looked more or less the same as each other. And this was the beginning of the realization that there were a lot of different patterns that had this strange property of non-repeating and yet highly, highly structured. How do we know patterns like this never repeat themselves? That really depends on the rules that they're given by. So each one of these has to come with some kind of description as to how you make them. And one of the ways in which, one of the most common ways in which patterns like this are found, are by taking a very regular pattern but in a much higher dimensional space, and then cutting through that space at an irrational angle. And the irrationality of the way you've cut it will mean that you'll never get complete repetition. Penrose tilings have been the origin of a lot of excitement for some time, really since the mid-1980s when this story started. Penrose discovered his tilings in the 70s, and 10 years later they were discovered to be out there in nature. And Dan Schleckman found that he could make an alloy of various different types of metal, and the atomic arrangements that went into this alloy, the way the atoms sat, arranged themselves on a sort of three-dimensional version of a Penrose tiling. And it took quite a while for it to be fully established, but I guess it now really is definitively established that this is so. As you got the Nobel Prize for Chemistry this last year.
Why had people not found it in nature before, if it's sort of and there's a natural tendency towards it?
Well, this is a very interesting, perhaps philosophic question about the nature of language, because one good answer, and I do believe this is a good answer, is we didn't see it because we didn't look for it. I think the story to tell at this point is the way in which some years ago, I think it was the 1930s, material was found that, with hindsight, we realised was based on similar sort of non-repeating patterns. But we didn't have the mathematics, the pure mathematics, the geometry had not been discovered, and we didn't have the language to be able to either talk about it or see it. So I find it a great example of how science can't see what it doesn't have the language to describe.